Hello, everyone. In the previous videos, we have learned what machine learning algorithms are, classification of machine learning algorithms, and the entire process of the entire machine learning algorithm. So in this section of the video, we will need to learn several very important concepts. These concepts are very common and important in machine learning. The first one is gradient descent. Sometimes we also call it gradient descent method. This is a training method for machine learning. On the left is its definition, optimization idea of gradient descent method. It is the negative gradient direction of the current position. Pay attention here. The negative gradient direction serves as the search direction. This direction is the fastest descent direction from the current position. So here, everyone might feel, is this progress a bit too fast? Why do we have to change instantly? Find the fastest descending direction. What is this for? At this location, we can briefly explain to everyone, when will this gradient descent method be used? Let's all remember, in our last video, do we have an indicator like MAE, evaluate our return task? How did it go? Can everyone still remember this indicator? MAE also has a metric called MSE. It is a measure of our predicted value. What is the difference between the predicted value and the actual value? We said at that time, we hope that our difference becomes smaller and smaller. Training error is decreasing, so we also hope as much as possible. Our margin of error in crime is getting smaller and smaller. That's a story for another time. Let's first talk about our training process. We want to make this training error smaller and smaller. Do we need to find the minimum value of this training error? That's the lowest point. Now let's look at the diagram on the right. The graph solved by the gradient descent method. If this colored plane, it's our MAE or that MSE. It should be more accurate to say it's MSE. The surface of possible values for this training error. So we need to find the lowest point of this training error. At this point, we might start with, its value will be in any aspect. How do we optimize those parameters? Until our training error reach this lowest point, we need to use our gradient descent method. Achieve this. At the beginning, we may be at any point, for example, any point drawn on this diagram. At this point, I need to find this point. The direction of our negative gradient at this moment, multiplying the learning rate by the negative gradient at the same time. Optimize the coefficient for each of our iterations. The one in front represents the coefficient. Continuously optimize these parameters, then seek to calculate based on these parameters. The difference between the predicted value of the model and the actual value is the smallest, so this is our gradient descent method. Role. It can play. Can everyone understand this? What is the result achieved then? It's the convergence written here. Objective function value. What we refer to as, what is the value of this objective function? It's the value of MSE. It is very small or reach the maximum number of iterations. The maximum number of iterations for this. Everyone, please pay attention. Sometimes we may just not be able to reach that minimum value. I wouldn't let my computer do that, calculating there all the time. At this point, I need to set up a 1,000 times, or how many times I will stop once I reach this number. This is an introduction to the gradient descent method. These two pictures. Actually, it expresses the same meaning. The following image. Just need everyone to remember one point. And it's okay. Two paths are discovered by everyone. Has it reached a lowest point? But what is the difference at this lowest point? This point is different from the other point. Is it a bit lower? In other words, gradient descent is prone to getting stuck in a local minimum. Instead of the global minimum point, this is a problem that will exist in gradient descent. In this photo, let's take a look at other variations of gradient descent. First batch, gradient descent method. Then there are stochastic gradient descent and mini batch gradient descent. Now let's take a look at its definition. Batch gradient descent refers to the samples in the dataset. Sample in all data. Update the weights by summing its gradients. From the formula, we can also see. Is it? It requires and then requests an average. Then proceed to complete the update operation. Calculate sum and average here. Stochastic gradient descent. As long as there is a point, I will start to update it. A sample in a data set. Update the weight parameters. Mini batch, gradient descent. What method was adopted? It combines the characteristics of these two. Both of the former are a bit too extreme. Either take all. Either take one. Mini batch gradient descent. How was it obtained? It takes N samples from them. Use it as a batch. I hope everyone can remember this concept, batch. When we are building neural networks, batch is a very important hyperparameter. That is to say, I just need to set how many batch, I just use how many samples, check my weight parameters, perform an update operation. The main difference is reflected here. Let's take a look. Three types of gradient descent methods. Are there pros and cons to each, or they are compared? How are they performing? Let's recall SGD. How does it update weight parameters? Each sample. It just updates once. What consequences will this bring? Here, instability. Everyone can see this purple part. This purple part is the instability. The most obvious representative. It twists and turns here, continuously update weights. Although it finally reached that final point, but everyone, think about it. If you have a noise point at this time, you may have been led astray by this noise point throughout the whole process. Now let's take another look at BGD mini batch gradient descent. It is very stable. It is the most stable. You can tell by looking at the blue part. It's almost heading straight towards our best optimization point. What are the shortcomings of BGED? It consumes too much computational resources. Let's all think about it. Every time you update the parameters, you need to calculate all the samples. If your sample set is relatively large, 10,000, 100,000, 1 million. Is the process of updating this parameter very slow? So, both SGD and BGD are too extreme. Either all or one mini-batch gradient descent is the best compromise. So, the concept of this batch here, let me emphasize this again to everyone, batch, as a hyperparameter, is very important. If you choose a batch size that is too small, you may have leaned towards stochastic gradient descent. If you select a batch size that is too large, you may be leaning towards batch gradient descent. So the concept of batch in mini-batch gradient descent is very important. So when we were explaining batch just now, it mentioned that it is a very important hyperparameter. We all know the parameters. But what are hyperparameters? In this chapter, let's take a look at the parameters and hyperparameters in the model. In the model, there should not only be parameters, but also hyperparameters. Parameters refer to the components in your model, the weights needed itself. Those parameters, hyperparameters, are more human-made, manually set, relevant numbers. Hyperparameters. Everyone can take a look. In this picture on the right side, it is a rather vivid metaphor. We all know. During the process of training this model, just need to train this model better. How can we demonstrate that this model has been trained well? Our parameters are very good because of these very valuable parameters. Our model can adapt to a variety of environments. So these parameters are like extracted from the data, the most precious part distilled out to lubricate our entire model. It's like lubricant can make our model run very well. Where is it distilled from? It's from here. It is distilled from these data, the fire needed to distill it. It's the training process. Recycle. You need to keep adding fire to it constantly. Repetitive training. Distill those parameters out from the data. So the most important thing is underground, seen. It's like the switch inside our liquefied gas stove. Same as the adjustment button. Adjust the size of the fire for us. Or it is regulating the entire distillation training process. This is the role played by hyperparameters. Hyperparameters can help you with training or help you distill better parameters. This is the role of hyperparameters. Everyone can think carefully about it if you keep steaming with a relatively low heat. Unable to steam if it's on fire. You may have steamed out a lot of impurities. That's how the hyperparameters are. You only need to provide him with the best hyperparameters, you can get that best model. This is the difference between parameters and hyperparameters. By now, I believe everyone has a clear understanding of what parameters and hyperparameters are. The parameter is learned automatically by the model. Hyperparameters need to be manually set by humans. Here we will explain in detail again, model hyperparameters. It is usually applied in the process of estimating model parameters. Moreover, designated directly by practitioners. Moreover, the hyperparameters of the model are usually set in an inspired manner, or sometimes it will be set in an experiential way, based on your experience or your own idea to set up the hyperparameters of that model. Usually adjusted according to the given model, need to make continuous adjustments. So here, let's take a look at some actual examples. What are hyperparameters? For example, the lambda in the Lasso Ridge regression is a hyperparameter. In KNN, the K is also a hyperparameter. The number of trees in a random forest is also a hyperparameter. In addition, in the support vector machine, these C values are hyperparameters. These are not trained through algorithms in the training process. Learned by itself. It is when you need to call this algorithm, you go to manually assign it a number. So this is the hyperparameter. What are some methods for obtaining hyperparameters? It's a search process. We gave him a detailed introduction on this film. We can see first the data set was divided into training, validation, and testing sets. Then, based on the performance metrics of the model on the training set, optimizing parameters. Then, on the validation set. We had a validation set before. At that time, we said that we would provide a detailed introduction to the hyperparameters in the later part. The main function of the validation set, searching for the optimal hyperparameters. This is a search process for hyperparameters. If the optimal hyperparameters are not found, iterate back and forth in two or three steps. You can find the optimal hyperparameter. Of course, your hyperparameters. It is necessary to continuously make adjustments. So, how to make adjustments? There are so many methods: grid search, random search, heuristic, intelligent search, and Bayesian search. So here we focus on introducing two methods, grid search and random search. This is the grid search method. Everyone can take a look. As the name suggests, we will list the hyperparameters as a grid. There are two hyperparameters here, so it is a flat. Grid. Three hyperparameters form a three-dimensional grid. 4, 5, 6 hyperparameters, that is, a hypercube grid. The search method is also very simple. Here, possibly the hyperparameter 2 on this side. There are 5 possible values of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 value options. So, hyperparameter 1, it is also 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 possible values. Correspondingly, go for retrieval 1 by 1. Pair them up and take them out. It might be 00 for the first time, the second time is 01. The third time is 10. The fourth time is 02. The third time is 20. Losing one by one, like this. So grid search is a very expensive method, a time-consuming method. So in that chapter on deep learning, we will talk about it again. In the field of deep learning, not very adapted to the method of grid search. What is random search like? Random search is used when the search space is relatively large. It will have a better effect than grid search. For example, this space is very large. Each point inside could be. The graph here shows every point could be the hyperparameter he is looking for. So I will randomly select some points, perform a search. At this time, I will find the best subset of hyperparameters. As the final hyperparameter, These two concepts are very simple. The principle is not difficult. In some common machine learning frameworks, there are also mature algorithms available for everyone to use. Next is cross-validation. Where does this connect to? Take the validation set we mentioned just now. We just said we need to use the validation set to obtain our hyperparameters. Find our optimal hyperparameters. How does he use this validation set? It's cross-validation. Let's take a look at its definition. Cross-validation is a statistical analysis method used to validate the performance of classifiers. Its basic idea is to group the original data, in some sense. Part of it serves as the training set, part of it serves as the validation set. Refers to the original training set. We need to divide further. Originally, only training and testing were separated. Now the training needs to be divided again, split into training and validation. Then train with the training set. Use the validation set to test the model, trained in testing. How to evaluate the performance indicators of the classifier at this moment. At this point, we use the validation set to evaluate this model. To adjust hyperparameters. This is for tuning hyperparameters, not to do other things. Adjust your parameters, but to adjust hyperparameters. Everyone needs to pay attention to this place. So the most typical and classic algorithm, K-fold, cross-validation, divide the original data into K parts. Validate each subset of data separately. So simple. If I were a threefold cross-validation divided into three parts, the first time he did the verification, others do the training, the second training for the second time. Other verification. The third time is to continue in this way. K is the number of parts you want to divide into. That's the way it is. So, in this picture here, I believe the explanation is quite clear now. Initially, it was the entire data set. Under normal circumstances, we need to divide into training and testing. Two completely unrelated parts. If cross-validation is added, we also need to further separate this part from the original training set. Part of it is verification. This is the most crucial part of cross-validation. Arrived here, we have just finished introducing several important concepts in machine learning to everyone. So, in the upcoming video, we will introduce several very common ones. Very common, it is also a very important machine learning algorithm for everyone, so there is also a lot of content coming up next. Very important. Next video, we will also split into two short videos to introduce to everyone. Goodbye.